We are at Filani and we're donating some bags, first of all, and then we are just gonna help out in any way we can, whether it's painting or cleaning or just entertaining. So I'm so excited.
Folding all the donations we brought for Filani, and we have a whole pyramid here. We have hats and baby clothes and reusable diapers.
I'm speechless. It was so amazing. I loved it so much. That really close interaction with complete strangers is just something so alien to me, but it just, now I just love South Africa. Filani was amazing. We got to meet the two women who put this organization together, and it was incredibly inspiring to see how dedicated they were in their organization, and they're so committed to helping other people. It's really inspiring, and I wish I could do something like that with my life every day.
There's all mountain ranges all around this place. Sun shining on the mountains, and just really, really exciting. We're about to go get on a boat to go to Robben Island, where Nelson Mandela was held.
Story with us. I know and probably a lot of other people are going to cherish this and remember it for the rest of our life, so thank you. I know that you've been part of the anti-apartheid movement for most of your life now, and I was curious to know if there was, and had a lot of hope, and you fought, and I was curious to know if there was a moment when you knew that change was going to come.
We started to get the strength, most especially when we were amongst our leaders. And then when we got news from outside, when people say abolish apartheid, and that this trend goes, was always moving in all the time. And then that is why we used to sing the songs that we shall overcome. So we knew that one day we will. And I remember when Mandela got released, I can tell you, in this particular area, some people were saying, I'm going to be a policeman, I'm a lawyer, I'm going to be a lawyer and charge them and bring them here. So we had those things here, honestly, at them. And that thing was always in our mind. And we even encouraged, some prisoners were very discouraged here. Some of them say that they've just lost hope that things will never come right. But we keep them, we keep their spirit high. And then that's why that hope, it never goes. We always had the hope.
That we can all live in peace someday.
Yesterday morning at around 11, Mr. F.W. de Klerk came to our hotel and we had a nice room set up for him where we got to interview him for about an hour. I wasn't really sure what to expect. You know, I'd heard different things from different people, and I think he was incredibly thought-provoking and incredibly thoughtful. And those two things combined, when you ask a good question, I think you get a really interesting conversation.
May I say also welcome to South Africa. I hope that the rest of your stay will also be productive. To understand South Africa, there's, apart from other things, one basic fact which one must accommodate in your thinking. And that is the complexity of our diversity. Imagine an America with 11 official languages. Think of the implications of that for education. So always keep in mind, because I think foreigners have, when they think about South Africa, they think black, white, apartheid, black and white. It's much more complex than that. Black diversity is also a force in our social fabric. The melting pot theory, which worked until now for America, where all the German groups and the Swedish and the English and so on and so forth were melted into one pot and you speak American, cannot work in South Africa. And our constitution recognizes that by saying we have 11 official languages. We have to make each of these linguistic groups, each one of these must feel that they are valued and appreciated building blocks of the greater whole, which is the South African nation. And that is our challenge.
De Klerk was incredible. He really gave me a different perspective on just kind of South Africa as a country and, you know, its history and everything that's happened here. And he kind of, as apartheid developed and passed and, you know, everything that happened with that, and it really helped me understand kind of where he was coming from and how the process was for him.
Tembisa was amazing. We've been here for 3 days working on songs.
We've been working really hard for these past few days, so it was really rewarding to be able to really experience it and just have a ton of fun with it.
We are in Tembisa and we're just about to perform, and we're going to be singing some songs, and I'm so excited. And this is my friend Tembi. She's my friend Tembi, and we're very close. We just clicked like this, and everybody's been saying we're twins. And she keeps saying that I'm a little bit African.
Yeah. She's African. Everything that she does, African. I think her mother, is your mother black?
Up there on stage with them, just singing and, you know, watching the crowd get up and dance was just so much fun.
This is gonna be our last day here, so I'm gonna miss these guys. Made some good friends.
I really enjoyed it. It was showing one spirit. We were united. That was so cool. That's the part that I really like.
I are going to interview Desmond Tutu. I think we have a really good set of questions we're going to ask him. And I think we're going to learn a lot. He's going to have a lot of interesting things to say.
Yeah, I think we've made an enormous amount of progress in the past couple of days. I think we've really done a lot of work, and I think it's paid off. We have a good arc, a lot of questions, and a lot of interesting things to ask him, and I'm really excited about what we're going to hear.
Hi, my name is Ruby, and I am curious to know what you felt at the moment when you took Mandela's hand and stepped out onto the balcony to introduce him as the next president of South Africa.
Oh, I mean, there are things that are indescribable. Can you describe your first kiss? No, but I think actually, I mean, that there are things, I mean, when you become a father for the first time, I mean, you really are at a loss for words to describe how you feel when you hold that little life in your hands. And I'll tell you actually what I said quietly to God. I said to God, after I introduced Madiba to the crowds in South Africa and in the world, I said, God, if I die now, I really don't mind. I won't mind. I mean, it was just an incredible moment, almost really indescribable. That, I mean, it was like a dream, yeah.
One of the most meaningful things to me was when he looks directly at you, you can really feel he's just so sweet and his laugh is so contagious. And it's really awesome to see how much he can impact you just by looking at you and saying, something incredibly simple can mean so much, and I know I'll definitely remember it for a very long time.
We are going to Bochabello. It's an AIDS orphanage, and so these kids come to Bochabello with, and they usually have HIV, and or they don't have parents or both, and so they have home and suburb and the bed to live in. So it's a great organization. So excited to meet the kids.
Going to Bochabello. You're gonna go and hang out with a bunch of little kids, and it's gonna be awesome. There's a dream.
It's just amazing how these kids can, you know, go through all this pain and sadness, but still be happy and just move on with their lives. Most of their families, parents, like friends and family, they've all died from this horrible disease. And what they teach at Bochabello is to move on with your life. And that's what really struck me. It was really amazing.
Everybody on the village, all our kids, everybody comes up and we clean the graves. So you'll find a lot of our kids have somebody here. And I think mostly everybody here, guys, if you want to take any of the visitors to go and look at your family, no problem. So just choose somebody and then you can go and show them where your family member is.
You see, I'm gonna go to the The little boy that I was with all day, we kept talking about his brother, and it never crossed my mind that his brother was no longer with him. And then he was talking about how his brother was his best friend, and then we went up to the graveyard and he introduced me to his brother. I mean, I just didn't even know what to do. I was just at a loss for words. I can't even imagine what that must be like, but he was still just so happy, and he was only 5 years old and he just could deal with it. You would not even think that these kids were living in extreme poverty, had AIDS or anything. All they wanted to do was for you to be happy. They didn't think about themselves. They put you before themselves, even though we just met them. I mean, in the one day that we were there, I made a friendship with this little boy that it's taken me years to get with other people. It was just an amazing experience.